appeals. Before we get started, the public service. Tonight's meeting of the ZBA is being recorded for RCTV Live on Comcast Channel 22 or Verizon Channel 33. The videographer for tonight's meeting is Rob. Check www.rctv.org for more information and for replay times. We're, as an accommodation to town council, we're going to, everybody's been informed, we're going to switch things up a little bit. We're going to hear the 40B petition second. We're going to start with the case 1703, so I'll go ahead and read the notice. The Zoning Board of Appeals will hold a public hearing in the Selectmen's Meeting Room at Town Hall, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Massachusetts, on Thursday, May 11, 2017, at 7 p.m. on the application of Rachel Proya, pursuant to MGL Chapter 40A, Section 9, for a special permit for an accessory apartment under Zoning Bylaws Sections 4.4 and 532 and 547, and pursuant to Mass General Laws Chapter 48, Section 6, for a variance from the Zoning Bylaws Section 5473B for property located at 62 Belmont Street in Reading, Massachusetts. Unless there's an objection, I'll dispense with the reading of the abutters list, except to say that the abutters were notified, as were all the pertinent boards and commissions in town, members and associate members of the Board of Appeals, as well as the planning boards of surrounding communities. Testimony given before this board is taken under oath, so including the applicant, if you think you may wish to speak, please stand and raise your right hand. Anybody that would like to speak, doesn't hurt to be sworn in now. Please stand, ma'am. Thank you. I swear that the testimony given by me before this board will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. The response is I do. The applicant has the floor.
So the first thing to point out is it's no longer a request for a variance. It's only a special permit. So there were some initial miscommunications, I guess, because the rule changed, so we changed it to special permit only. I believe that the floor plan you have is with revised version.
All right. We didn't receive any notice on that, did we, from the town?
No, and I wonder, upon wondering, query whether or not this needs to be re-noticed. You do? Just special permit?
Special permit and a variance.
Yeah. No, it's variance, variance and special permit.
Right.
So let me think about that for a second. Sorry.
In fact, we just got a letter from the, it wasn't in our packet, but we just got it tonight with our information, the denial from the building inspector, or zoning officer, but it was dated April 20th.
Okay.
And again, it was noted in that that there was a requirement for a special permit and a variance because of that 825 square foot
right when he
overage.
When he told me that it required a variance, so I came back and redid the floor plan because originally we had thought that it didn't require a variance. There was a misunderstanding with the new rule that was, I think, from November.
So.
Packets they sent out, they said they were including the updated information.
I don't think it had a revised.
Right, I don't have a revised notice. I have a variance and a special permit.
Right.
Now,
I'm going to be honest with you, David, if I could interject.
Sure, please do.
I think our whole packet tonight indicates that it is an oversized accessory apartment, so we couldn't even vote on it because we have nothing to base our decision on. There's no plan or architectural plans. Everything is based on, you know, something that's an oversized accessory apartment.
Right, right. And so.
Yeah.
So. Pages 3.1. This
again
on the plan.
Maybe we should verify that we have the right plan.
Yeah.
We've got a plan from
do not.
From Professional Building Systems.
Yeah, it should be on page 3.1.
dated May 1st.
Hmm.
Was it with this letter?
I'm looking to see.
When did that come? Did that come to us in the mail?
No, this came with this, what?
Today's packet?
Yeah.
Give me a little quick second because.
Yep, so it's.
No, I didn't.
It was with this letter.
Oh, yeah, we just got the letter.
Yeah, and I had this with it. This was with it. It was like this.
Really?
Yeah.
I didn't get that.
You didn't get it. And I have everything mixed up now, so.
I just got the letter, I believe.
It's not with the main packet.
Maybe I missed it.
The date is different, so I can tell. It's dated May 1st.
That's not your house.
I haven't seen it.
So that's where we.
What's confusing is I think the other one is also wearing the white one.
I think it came with that one, yeah.
Well, that's part of the problem. Remember, you got a package for 1704? In the mail?
Yep.
It was in that package.
Oh, I thought we got it today. I have it.
An envelope with 1704.
That's on my kitchen table at home.
That's on my.
I grabbed it.
Yeah, right.
It was just a plain plan. It didn't indicate what it was to or anything. It was just kind of a loose plan, if I remember. Yeah.
Okay. All right, so let's think about how to be fair and equitable, but also to keep with what it is we're here to do tonight. So.
I have a question, two questions.
Go ahead, go ahead.
Question number one was, in the architectural plans, whether they are the original ones or the ones that you upgraded and gave us that we all don't seem to have, I didn't see any calculations at all for the justification for the primary versus the accessory apartment.
This is in the second packet. So it's all listed out right there. I did have a.
Oh, no. Well, yes. I did my own calculations separately from what you had on the plan. And I came up with basically, well, anyways, I didn't see any justification for that your architect or your engineer or whomever was doing it to justify the criteria in the bylaws. And the second thing that I came up with is I see that from viewing the property is that you want to relocate your driveway from the left-hand side of the property to the right-hand side of the property.
Yes.
That's a curb cut change. We've already been through that once with the selectmen, and the only person that can authorize that is the selectmen. So regardless of what we do, that can't even go forward until you get permission from the, that I think of, that you can go forward with that until the selectmen have viewed that as a possibility.
Well, we could.
Condition it.
We could condition for it and, you know, not require the applicant to get selectmen approval before being before us, but it would be a subject to approval of the selectmen for the curb cut.
Okay.
And we could condition for it. So I'm looking in the town's, you know, the building department's folder. And so this new information was submitted on April 20th, am I correct? The new information?
It was around that time. It was right after I received the email from the building inspector.
And May 1. Okay. See if I have one dated May 1. I'm sure it's probably in the file if we already have it. If the town sent, you know, if the staff sent it to us, we probably already have it. May 1. I don't even see them here.
Yeah.
even see it in here. All right, so. All right, so we have an issue with regard to the publication and notice, first of all. Because the notice was, well, the notice was provided to abutters that there would be a variance as well.
Right.
As a special permit. So I guess we could, in order to do this, well, we have two ways to do this, to make it sound, I think, legally. We either A, require the applicant to republish with the amended, updated petition, which would require essentially restarting the process to do a special permit. Or, because the applicant has submitted an application for a variance, but wishes to withdraw the application for a variance, we could vote on the withdrawal if they want us to, because are we certain that this doesn't require a variance? You made some calculations.
Well,
the applicant has made some calculations.
You don't know that without having reviewed the revised print.
Right, right. And
whether it does or does not meet the criteria.
Right, and so some of us have that revised print, and some of us don't.
We all have it. We just don't have it with us.
Well, right.
right,
but I mean here. And so are we...
Well, can I give you a third option then?
Sure.
Third option would be to continue the subject matter of this case to a date forward, which wouldn't require us to republish it. It'd allow sufficient time for us to get out the current information and anything that the petitioner wishes to provide us with down the line also. And the major issue with me is that even with this set of plans, with the unrevised, the calculations to me don't make the cut.
Yeah, unrevised.
So, well, I mean, there's several things that don't make the cut. So I would think in terms of the time factor, since it might be easier to do it this way, the subject matter of the case, we could, upon the continuance, get all the information we have, gives us time to go back and look at it. We put it a date forward. It doesn't have to be. Kim, what do we have for dates?
We have
May 18th, we have just one case, Howard Street.
And June 1st, we have that continued case from Franklin Street.
I think it makes sense to continue the case.
I think so too.
I don't think I'm in a position to be able to have enough information in front of me to be able to vote on your petition right now. I realize that is not something that you want to hear presently.
Correct.
But I don't. It didn't make its way to us sufficient for us to be able to review that information to make an informed. I don't even have a plan to stamp.
Right.
I don't even have a copy of the drawing. I mean, I could use one of these guys' drawings, I suppose, but
yeah,
I haven't even had a chance to take a look at it yet.
Yeah. But it's also, and I just took a quick glance at Catherine's, and it's an incomplete set of the architect. It's just one drawing out of the architectural, 3.1. It's
right.
Not the whole set or anything.
The original packet has all the other pages.
Yeah.
That was just a replacement page,
right,
that was supposed to be inserted.
So maybe it doesn't. Maybe that's the only drawing that was affected. I don't know. I would think not.
No, that's the only one.
Elevations, I mean, you had the front view may not change, but you had side views, rear view, side
true.
Views. They don't change.
It's an internal
but yet
floor plan change.
But yet you cut. Okay.
So, but you're enlarging the footprint of what you revised here versus what...
No.
The footprint
no,
is
just,
stayed the
we
same?
We changed the floor plan to take room out of the accessory apartment. That's all we did.
so that it would be a smaller accessory apartment to meet the one-third requirement of the main house.
So that they wouldn't need a variance.
I see, so the main house is extended into that, let's call, for the lack of a better word, that L.
Yeah.
Where the accessory is, so the main house is extended for a bit into that before you hit the, okay.
I'm interested in feedback, and then I'll make a decision.
What I would be comfortable with, David, number one, is the building inspector to take a look at this and give us a letter saying what's required. I mean, the only letter I have right now is the one we received tonight, which says a variance and a special permit, or a special permit and a variance is required because it's 825 square feet above the maximum allowed. I would like to see you get back with the building inspector, and we get a revised letter from the building inspector saying now that it only requires a special permit if that's in fact what you feel it does. And then at that time, when you came back, you could withdraw your request from a variance if the building inspector so agrees with you. We could withdraw the request for the variance and then go ahead and hear the arguments for a special permit for an accessory apartment. If in fact that's all that's required is the special permit.
According.
But I would find it different. I mean, to me.
Yeah.
I put a lot of faith into what the building inspector, he's the one that's out there in the field measuring and looking at the plans and reviewing them. He's the one that's gonna decide, does it require a special permit or does it require also a variance?
If you look at the revised floor plan, when you do, basically what you're doing is you're taking a section out of the accessory apartment, the beginning part of the main house. So
yeah.
You're making the main house bigger and the accessory apartment smaller.
Right.
What you're doing.
Exactly.
What are your thoughts?
My thoughts? I'd like to be sitting here making a decision based on having all the current material available, mm-hmm. Okay? But if in fact what she's done, and it would certainly make sense that it gets rid of, it would get rid of the variance just by based on looking at it.
Right.
Talking about permit, and it's almost straight sailing.
As long as it passes muster with the
time
government.
It would make sense to me, the suggestion you made, it makes sense to me to continue this thing to a later session. We can try to make it as quickly as possible, because I think this is gonna be relatively straightforward.
Right, so I think you've heard from the board, and I'm inclined continue the case to the next available date, which is a week from tonight.
And how do I make sure that you all get everything
that
need.
Might be tough.
Well,
tomorrow's an off day.
Well,
for town, and so the quickest she could get into see the town people is Monday, right, Kim?
Well,
Tuesday.
And Glenn's here Tuesday.
You can come in and speak to Julie on Monday.
I spoke with Julie.
Well, that's because you spoke to two different people. So let's just stick with Julie because she's the one that took it over, and that's why Glenn took done. So come in and talk to Julie on Monday. I'll verify with you exactly what is needed.
Okay, can I ask you then, because Julie's already reviewed this,
mm-hmm.
So what do I need from her to state that she's reviewed it or whatever you need next week? Because she's already reviewed it.
Okay, so we don't have anything in here from Julie, and I understand she's helping out at the counter and is being helpful to you and trying to get you through this process. But what we'd really need is some information from Glenn, from the building inspector, that updates his opinion and his guidance to you, that updates his letter of April 20th, that is the basis for the notice going out and the basis for what we're being asked to look at and the guidance that we're getting from the town that says that you need both a variance and a special permit. And so if after review, town staff provides us with something in writing, and we prefer that it come from Glenn, but if it can't, you know, somebody else that amends Glenn's letter, at the very least, that the new plans have been, the amended plans have been reviewed in that the application is better brought as a special permit without a need for a variance. By that time, and by this time next week, We'll hopefully have that. I can't imagine that that's a Herculean effort. It seems like it would be something pretty simple. We'll all have had a chance to review the updated plans that the town sent to us, and be in a better position to get you out of here quickly, probably that night.
Does anybody need updated plans? I have two copies I can hand you right now, if you didn't receive it.
The only plan that's changed is 3.1.
Yeah, 3.1.
That's the only document that's changed.
Correct, and there's one behind it. It's also called 3.1, or might not be. I just, in red, outlined the accessory apartment and put the calculations next to it, so that you could see it clearly.
Okay.
He ought to see those.
Could I take a sec, so I can...
Yeah.
Over Glenn's signature.
Let's, yeah, let's...
Put it in the file and talk to, talk to people I need to talk to.
You want me to put it in the file, Kim?
Nope, because I'm gonna bring it back and start it tomorrow.
Okay, good, all right. All right, so, that makes things as clear as mud. No, so, from our standpoint, we think it would be better to continue the matter to May 18th, which is a week from tonight. And we would need to do that by a motion to continue with your consent. You're okay moving it a week so we can get this straightened out? So I'll entertain a motion to continue 1703 to Thursday, May 18th at 7. So moved. Do we have a second?
Second.
Second, Robert. All right. Any discussion on the continuance? Not hearing none. Oh, John?
Whoever's doing this, updating this, I'd like to see the calculations for the accessory apartment versus the primary.
On the engineered plans, I don't know if I can get those by next week. They take several weeks to get them. I'm still waiting for them.
Well, what we're suggesting is that in order to determine whether or not the dimensions and the calculations come within the zoning bylaw requirements, we would need to and want to have the calculations that John referred to be able to refer to those. And candidly, you'd probably want us to see those to make sure that they're in keeping with what you're requesting. That said, given that there perhaps might be a time constraint with getting that to us in time for next Thursday, I mean, maybe a further continuance, I guess. So the next date, well, let's talk about it. The next date after May 18th is June 1st. That's what, 2 weeks away, almost 3 weeks away?
Mm-hmm, almost.
Yeah, 3 weeks away. Would that provide you with enough time to get that information back from your engineer?
I would assume so. However, I'm sort of confused if, I mean, once you approve it based on the fact that it would meet that requirement.
The submission that you present to the board should have the measurements and dimensions calculations, the square foot totals, that show the accessory apartment versus the dimensions and the total square foot of the principal residence, so we'll be able to readily run that through our process to make sure that it comes within the dimensional requirements for under the bylaw.
Is there a way to get that specified how you need to do that? Because when I asked for that before, the plan shows the total house, but they don't have a way to show that separately for the accessory apartment, unless they just type it on there themselves.
You got a comment, Ty?
Yeah. What was in our package were two pieces of paper. One showing the 3.1, and another one which was with it, which shows the layout, and it does have the square footage calculations on it.
No, it doesn't.
Huh?
It's net versus gross, and hallways, bathrooms, et cetera, are excluded. When you look at the original set of plans, it's very difficult, even with the magnifying glass, to see some of the dimensions and actually calculate them out. building inspector is assuming that this is done by the engineer and it's correct.
Do you have the page two that?
This is, no, this is.
That's not the updated pack.
No, I don't.
Si has, so here, take a look at this.
That's the new one.
That's the new one, there's calculations on it.
Yes, and she, no, it just shows the one calculation, accessory apartment versus the primary. I mean, that doesn't, the other thing that I look at too is, I don't, well, it's not for me to say, but I don't see a second means of egress out of the accessory apartment now that you redefined this, and that's just quick.
It's on the kitchen side, so the kitchen.
That's one, you need two.
The other one is from the main house, can I show you?
That's the entrance from outside, that's the entrance to the accessory apartment.
So what is here?
This is the foyer, and that goes into the main house.
You have to have two independents. Again, I don't wanna get into this, that's the building inspector's decision to make, not.
Okay, so.
It states that it can be an interior.
But not through the existing primary structure.
All right, so we're in a position where we, no, that's size.
That's size.
All right, so, the board feels that it would be better to have a more complete application. We don't have all the materials that we should have to be able to render a decision tonight. The board has requested, I guess, a more detailed calculation of the space. And are you telling me that the engineer won't be able to do that at all?
I don't know.
All right, well, certainly wouldn't be able to do it by next Thursday.
I don't know.
Okay. Do you wanna try to do it by next Thursday? So let's do it this way. Let's continue the matter to next Thursday. If, leading up to next Thursday, you find that you need more time, contact staff and we'll put you on for the next available meeting after that, which is June 1st. All right, but for now, let's try to get you back in here as quick as we can. And then, if we can't get you back in here, you know, you just let town staff know and we'll put you on the next one, which hopefully gives you enough time to get what you need to get. All right? All right, so we have a motion to continue to the 18th. We have a second. John's made some comments, we've gone through those. Is there any further discussion on that motion?
Just one.
Okay.
Rachel, the reason why I think the board is doing this, certainly myself, this is the first application before us with a, in the new bylaws for a new construction, including an accessory apartment. All we wanna do is make sure it's right the first time. You don't wanna get into a situation that's gonna take you into the courts, nor us either. So we wanna make sure that everything is there before the final decision is made.
I understand, and it's, that statement is appreciated. It's been rather difficult because of the change. So I've been told one thing about 15 times and then it changes, so it's kind of frustrating.
Yeah, we understand. All right, any further discussion on the motion on the table? Hearing none. All those in favor of the continuance? All right, we'll continue to May 18th. Thank you for your patience.
Thank you.
We're butters, and we haven't seen a plot plan. Are we allowed to see that, or how does that work?
The hearing is closed, ma'am, but I would suggest, I would suggest.
Sorry.
That's fine. I would suggest that you visit the town staff.
The town hall.
You can come to the town hall and request.
Okay.
Yeah, that's fine. They have it. Thank you very much. The envelope?
I did.
I opened the envelope. I saw a new application and some documents in there.
Must have been all put together.
And didn't even think, there was no indication that had documents related to tonight's hearing. Perhaps that could be made a little more clear for us. Right here, let's put this. All right, so one of the reasons why we did these out of order is to accommodate town council, who can't be here until about 7:45, but I don't want to make the applicant, wait.
We have a few things to get through in this.
Do we?
Maybe we can do the minutes first.
I don't think there are any minutes.
No.
Let me put it up next week.
Says in, didn't it say we had minutes tonight? Then I get two sets of minutes that I reviewed.
Two sets of minutes.
That's probably for next week. I think she's, I don't have any minutes in front of me.
Oh, why?
Oh, you didn't get. You guys can edit and just tell me, I'll type.
I got one set.
Maybe it's in the same package.
I don't think I got it. I think it's for next week.
Could be your.
There are two sets of minutes?
Two sets.
The next meeting?
Yeah, she said she wouldn't put them on the 40B night. She didn't want to add on to it.
Well, that makes sense.
It is next, on the next agenda.
Maybe, because I wasn't here for the last meeting.
Absolutely. All right, well, we're not gonna have any minutes tonight, because we don't all have.
Okay.
Yeah, that's the draft.
They're not.
I review them and put her comments on them.
Maybe they're stuck in. The last meeting, so I wanted to.
You see my comments.
Maybe they're stuck in the envelope that's on my kitchen table. All right.
You're right.
So. Okay. We have a continuation of the 40B, Reading Equitable Housing on next. We tried to accommodate town council's request to be here, but he'll get here and.
In 10 minutes, yeah.
You know, he'll be here, claims by about 7:45, but we ought to at least, I guess, get started and if town council needs to come up to speed a little bit or needs a synopsis of what's gone on in the interest of moving things along, we'll just get started. So the next case on for tonight is case 1701, and it's the continuation of a public hearing in the Selectman's Meeting Room at Reading Town Hall. Thursday, May 11th at 7 on the petition of Reading Equitable Housing LLC, who seeks a comprehensive permit to develop 20 units of rental housing within an existing three-story brick building on a 45,779 square foot residentially zoned tract of land under Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 40B, Sections 20 to 23, with waivers from zoning requirements on the property located at 172 Woburn Street, Reading, Massachusetts. Okay, so we have a number of things and a number of ways we can do this. Last time we met, we didn't hear from Nitch, right, Matt?
Yeah.
Yeah, we didn't hear from Nitch, and there's also been some Green International submissions, and it appears some updated plans, and then an updated from Attorney Latham. And so I guess what I, you know, unless the applicant disagrees, I think we'd let the applicant go first, update us on what's been updated, perhaps then hear from Nitch and then Green and, you know, and any further discussion that needs to happen. So everybody okay with that? You guys okay with that? Nitch, you okay with that?
Yeah.
Got no place else to be, right?
Nope.
So the floor is yours, Attorney Latham.
Good evening, Josh Latham here tonight for Reading Equitable Housing. Just to provide you an update, since our last hearing on April 6th, we did revise the plans in response to Nitch's and Green's comments. Jack Sullivan's here tonight to make a presentation just to quickly go over what those changes are. So we do have new site plan, new landscape plan. I also submitted a letter just to discuss and address some concerns the board had with regards to parking management and parking lot operation. So we addressed within that letter how the parking space would be assigned, signage with regards to two spaces for the church's use in front of the dumpster, and snow management. With that, if I could turn it over to Jack Sullivan.
Thanks, Josh. I just wanted to highlight to the board, for the record, my name's Jack Sullivan, owner of the Sullivan Engineering Group. From the last meeting, one of the larger concerns was traffic movement through the site. The board requested that the fire chief provide something in writing saying that he was acceptable to the 18-foot aisle widths for emergency access if in case there was ever an emergency to get into for fire suppression. I believe Josh did submit that letter. We did get it from Chief Burns and provided it to the board in your packets.
There was an email from Chief Burns to Julie, and that was submitted in the file. I have a copy tonight if you'd like to submit it to the board as well.
Okay. So that was one of the concerns. The other concern was previously in the rear parking area, I showed 22-foot aisles with 90-degree parking spaces, and there was some concern from Green that was tight, and it is tight, 22 feet was tight. So we left the last hearing and we said we'd reevaluate the parking, see what we could do. Where we have one-way circulation, I was able to increase the parking aisle to 24 feet along this stretch of the parking. So we still have the 9x18 parking spaces with a 24-foot aisle. There was concern also, we only had about 22 feet towards the rear of the site, and there was concern with movement through there. We increased that to 24 feet. And then what I did is I did angled parking along this section. And so with that, you can do a 14-foot aisle length and you get the parallel parking, the angled parking spaces to work. In doing that, we lost some parking for the site, which I told the board would happen. But we ended up only losing like 3 or 4 spaces. We're still above the minimum requirement of 30 parking spaces for this project. We need 1.5 parking spaces per unit. We have 20 units, so we need 30 parking spaces. And I have a total of 32. And that includes two handicap space spaces, one being a van accessible space. There was also a few other bookkeeping items. The fence lines, we showed fence lines, but they really, I didn't clearly label them as stockade, 6-foot stockade. Those were labeled. I know one member of the board on the construction detail had some concern on the guardrail on the church side, that be properly identified. I showed some various options that could be used. In the construction details, I picked one form of how the guardrail would be constructed so that the general contractor will know what is to be put in. So we also, in redesigning this back parking space, some items stayed the same. I still, 10 spaces to the rear of the site will be constructed of pervious pavers. I still kept the rain garden towards the back of the site. That's more of a landscape feature, but it's also to provide some TSS removal. Presently, the parking lot just sheet flows to the catch basins at the rear of the property. So with that rain garden feature, there'll be a little bit of storage volume. There's some slight pre-treatment with the riprap spillway into the rain garden, and then it'll overflow into the catch basins that ultimately leads to the 30-inch RCP drain. Another thing that came up from Green, they wanted to see more detail on site signage and pavement markings. Those have been added to the plan. And maybe the biggest thing that came out of the review, from the previous hearing, as you know, I had sent a detailed drainage analysis. Niche received it, in their defense, only about a week before the last hearing that we had. They were unable to come to the meeting. It wouldn't have allowed them enough time to get response back to you anyways. We did get comments back from Niche. We're basically in agreement on 99% of the site design and drainage. The one thing that came up is, and I talked to Matt today and he can talk a little bit on it as well, but I'm providing an infiltration field to capture the roof runoff for this site. We have sandy gravels on this property, but a high groundwater table. Groundwater table is only about 3 feet down. DEP storm stormwater guidelines require a 2-foot separation for new construction, for any infiltration system to the seasonal high groundwater table. I looked at this project as a redevelopment project, meaning the building's staying about the same, the parking lot is basically staying about the same, except on the Wenda Street side, we're expanding it by about 2 feet, so that we can have conforming parking spaces. So I looked at this as a redevelopment project, the town engineer looked at it as a redevelopment project, and when I talked to Matt today, he was basically saying he looks at this as new construction, meaning we'd have to meet all the requirements of DEP stormwater policy. And his reasoning was, and I'll let him speak to it, but I'll give a quick summary, he can correct me if I stated incorrectly, but by us adding this infiltration field and to provide the sufficient cover that they require over the Cultec units, we'll be changing grades in the parking lot by under 6 inches, but there'll be grade changes to support the cover we need over it. He stated by changing the grade in the parking lot area that he deemed that to be new construction. I disagree. So we have a disagreement. It's a friendly disagreement, but with redevelopment, I look at this, if you wanted to call this new construction, about 2% of the project would be new construction, 98% is redevelopment. We have an existing paved parking lot, we have an existing building, not much is changing. And what I explained to Matt today, which he was not privy to, is we did have 2 neighborhood meetings. I actually reduced the amount of impervious area on this site, so I technically could have said, I don't need to do any drainage. You know, I've reduced the amount of pavement, I've created some landscaped areas, but in meeting with the neighbors and what we convey to the neighbors, and that's why we really don't have opposition from neighbors, is a few of the neighbors on Wenda, towards the rear of this property, complained about drainage. So I said, I'll make an effort to deal with that, and I'll take the entire building out of the equation, put it into an infiltration field. I'll also provide a small rain garden. It's not going to give us any much engineering support for volume, but it will take a little bit out and provide before it gets into the town drainage system. So in explaining that to Matt, when he heard that, you know, it was something we offered up, but to get this to a point, technically, if it is considered new construction under the DEP stormwater policy, you would need the 2-foot separation. And for me to do that, I'd be raising the entire lot up a foot. I could be increasing rates of runoff onto abutting properties. I didn't want to get into that situation. So what we basically wanted to bring in front of the board tonight is we may need to request a waiver from the DEP stormwater to allow that 1-foot separation from the infiltration field to the groundwater table. I would see the benefit to the board is that technically I don't have to do any of this drainage, but goodwill to the neighbors and to sound engineering, I did provide it. If we're in a disagreement, then it triggers new construction, but to get through this, if everyone's on board with a waiver, I'm fine with supporting something like that. I did talk to the town engineer as well today. I think he was going to provide a memo to the board. I'm not sure if that made it. I didn't see a copy of it, but I was out of my office all day. He agreed with me that it was redevelopment in other cases in town, especially when I'm in front of the Conservation Commission. They look at redevelopment as long as you're not increasing the footprint of the impervious area on site or impervious surfaces. Even if you're regrading, it's still the same general impervious coverage of the lot. You're not increasing the footprint size. And under the Wetland Protection Act, I brought a copy of it, how they talk about it. It does say as long as degraded areas are not increased, degrading meaning any impervious surface, concrete surface, is increased. And as I said, it's only in this area that we basically increase it slightly. So that's basically the rundown. A lot of this came, the major change was the parking lot configuration, improving movements through the site, providing proper signage to you know, for safety and for people maneuvering through the site to know where they're going, especially where it's one way. And I also, even the dumpster location, it stayed the same, but I changed some how the parking was in there to allow movements for pickup of the refuse and recycling and movements think it's a much better design, even though we lost a few parking spaces. And I think Green, basically, besides a few minor comments, was in agreement with the plan, and I believe Nitch was basically in agreement with the plan, except what I highlighted on new construction versus redevelopment. Turn it back to the board for any questions or comments.
Before we do that, Chris, we had to get started a little bit earlier.
Sorry, I was a little late.
No, we, you know, we tried, but.
I appreciate that. Thank you.
So you missed Jack's presentation based upon the updated drawings is so far.
That's good.
Couple of questions I have. The fire chief signed off on those plans. When you say the fire chief is issued an approval of turn radiuses and widths, aisle widths, that was following the updating of that plan and of that plan?
Correct. If I could submit, this is a copy of the email. Julie had submitted to the fire chief and police chief these plans and requested their review and approval and follow-up to the DRT from over a year ago. And that was the fire chief's response, essentially saying there's no further issues with it and just looks forward to construction plans.
Okay. So as of the date, Monday, April 24th, that the fire chief sent this email over, he'd seen that?
Correct. If you look at below of Julie's email, it says these are the April 19th.
That's the 14th, April 19th plan?
Correct. That's the last revision date, April 19th.
Good. All right. Good. All right. We'll put that, we'll enter that into the record. Just a general question that I have regarding, you know, and we'll hear from the peer review consultant too, but I've not been asked or involved with a question whether or not this board has authority to, they requested perhaps that they may add a waiver regarding this board providing them a waiver from DEP requirements. And my query is, does this board have authority and something to think about to waive a DEP requirement? Kind of a hypothetical, but go ahead.
If I could answer, I don't believe that the DEP standards apply to us directly as a state standard. I believe it's almost a circuitous way of site plan review would potentially require that we need to conform with DEP standards as a local requirement.
So it's kind of an end around.
It is. We don't actually discharge into a wetland, so we don't actually have that jurisdiction here.
All right. Well, good food for thought, too. Okay. Any other board members have any questions of Jack, Robert?
You allude the, I was interested in if the fire chief had approved these plans, you might say, or written his memo on these plans, because I do see you have a 14-foot aisle width now where the angle parking is. But he has seen that and he's comfortable. Obviously, it's 18 feet along the building. So he can get into three sides of the building, and I think that's particularly what they look at is in fighting a fire is three sides of a building they can access.
That's correct.
But he has seen the 14 feet.
That's what he said at the first DRT meeting we had. He needs to be able to access it from three sides.
Okay.
And so where we have 18 feet on each side, and if he had to get on Woodward Street, he could. So he felt that's why he wrote the letter the way he did, because he feels he can get it from three sides.
Sure. And to go back, Jack, to your groundwater infiltration system now that you were discussing, and we're talking with, is it DEP, is it the town? And there's some conflicts with your with the town's peer reviewer.
Correct.
On that.
Yep.
But you did say you talked to the town engineer, and the town engineer is more in tune with your way of thinking in this in regards to?
And I think town council can speak to this,
okay,
too. I didn't initiate the call to the town engineer. I received a call.
Ah, okay.
And I initiated a call to Matt because I wanted, before we got to this hearing, you know, as professionals, to try to see if we could work something out. And we had a good conversation. We just disagree a little bit on how this is classified, but the same. You know, we had a good conversation about it. Ryan Percival called me saying town council had contacted him to discuss this and see if what his feelings were. And he told me he was going to put a memo together. I guess that didn't.
That's what I would like to see, something from the town engineer.
He did consider a redevelopment, and as most of my projects, when it's roof runoff, as with most municipalities where it's clean, they allow a 1-foot separation, not the 2-foot separation. It's not necessarily spelled out like that in the law, but like in Wakefield and Reading and Arlington and Lexington and the other towns I work with in front of the Conservation Commission, they'll accept a 1-foot separation when it's just roof. And on this site, it makes sense. If I could do the 2 feet, I would. But there's also, with redevelopment standards, you're supposed to meet DEP stormwater standards to the maximum feasible compliance. Meaning, you don't have to meet the letter of the law, but you try as hard to get to it as long as it's feasibly compliant. So in this case, to raise the entire parking lot a foot, change all the grades, some of the input we've had from the neighbors with concerns on drainage, and especially where I don't really even need the drainage field, but it was something to, I knew the town would like to see that as a part of this project. I knew the neighbors would. It seemed like a good design feature to put in. So really, as Matt said, the only reason that he looked at this as new construction is because we have to increase that grade over the infiltration field. If that wasn't there, all my grades would match, and then maybe it would be considered, in his opinion, redevelopment.
Personally, I would like to see something, this groundwater recharge. It may not, as you say, it just takes the roof runoff, but it's any little thing that could help with the runoff from the site. And I know there's been problems down there, with the neighbors and with the abutters, whether it is the amount of runoff, which right now the roof of the structure is included in that runoff that goes off, directly included in it. Whereas if there's an infiltration system, it'll be indirectly included. It has to go through the infiltration system first before it overflows and then go to the catch basin.
Correct.
So I think anything we could do to alleviate potential flooding problems for the neighbors, I applaud. And that's why I think, too, a maintenance plan, annual maintenance of the drainage system is required. And I think we noted this at the last meeting. I would like to see something like that. And I believe the
did include
the project proponent sounds like they're acceptable to that, to provide an annual maintenance of the storm drain system on site.
And you actually specifically mentioned the 2 catch basins at the rear of the site being clean, because who knows when the last time those were cleaned.
Exactly.
So Town of Reading's engineering department requires a stormwater report be submitted by January 15th of each calendar year. And I did provide an operation and maintenance plan for this system. I included that in my stormwater report and write in it. So when Mike owns it now, but when this gets going, he'll be responsible, or someone who works with him will be responsible for providing a report to the town annually.
Okay. That's it for me, David.
Yeah. Thanks, Ross. Too. Kathy?
I have nothing additional right now.
Thank you. John?
I just had a couple, but they're in the green report, so I don't want to.
Yeah, let's wait until we'll wait until.
Okay.
Zai?
Not at this time.
Nick?
Yeah, I just had a quick question. Could you clarify the distinction between the crush stone in the infiltration system and whether it's 6 inches or 1 foot? And if there will be times during the year where there will be standing water in that system?
There will not be standing water in the system. We're based on sands and gravels. When we ran the perk test, you could put a fire hose in, it couldn't hold water. So it's gonna, I mean, in a larger storm, it'll hold water, but the DEP wants to see these structures drain out within 72 hours. That's not gonna be a problem in this site. We have really good soils. Okay, so as far as the 1 foot separation, and what I did, and this is through experience, when you're on really sandy soils and you these Caltech units down, they can knife into the sand, okay? So this happened to me on a project in Foxborough. It knifed into the sand, so instead of having about 12 inches of open space in the Caltech, when they knife in, effectively you may only have 6 or 7 inches. It affects the efficiency of the system. So what I've started to do is I bed Caltechs on 6 inches of stone. I didn't take any credit for capacity of the 6 inches of stone. So it is true, the 6 inches of stone is within the 1 foot separation, but I didn't take any credit in my modeling for the 6 inches. So all my modeling only accounts for the Cultec unit itself. And it's really, especially over a paved area, I was afraid if I just bedded it on sand that I could have a knifing effect and Mike would be left with a problem in a couple of years. So it's really just engineering, hopefully sound engineering that makes the system function but better.
That clarifies it, thanks.
Okay.
Hey, Chris, do you have anything to add, subtract?
I do not.
Divide, multiply?
No.
Good.
No.
All right, so I guess what we'll do next is we'll turn it over to Niche to go through anything that you've submitted since either the last time we've met that we missed you or since then in response to or anything involved in your report.
Well, I just think since while it's still fresh in everyone's mind as part of the discussion, I think that there are a couple of semantic issues that should probably get clarified in terms of DEP standards and the ZBA's connection to that. So we agree that the DEP standards are linked to this process via site plan review regulations and not because of there are any state regulated areas that the site is tributary to. So the board is perfectly capable of waiving any and all those requirements that they so choose. However, because we were tasked with identifying areas where the project is not compliant with the zoning bylaw, the site plan review regulations, and by extension the DEP standards. That's why we identified those in this letter. And I think for each of those comments, or I think most of them, we also identified that the applicant may seek a waiver from those. If this was before the Conservation Commission, it was a state filing, they wouldn't really have the ability to request a waiver from those, but they do in this setting. So now, in terms of classifying the project, in that light, in terms of the standards that you presented with, in terms of the project being classified as a redevelopment project, it is classified as a redevelopment project because it's a previously developed site. We're using terms like new construction, et cetera. That term does not relate to the applicability of the DEP standards itself. Because it's a redevelopment project, there are certain leeway that's afforded by under the standards for provision of or meeting the performance standards for the site. Typically, a redeveloped site that includes reconstructed traffic areas like the parking lot in this project, it doesn't have anything to do with the grading or anything else. Because it's being reconstructed, that part of the project is considered to be, quote, new construction in terms of whether it needs to have water quality treatment provided for it. Okay, so there are two kind of main aspects of the standards that apply to this project. One's groundwater recharge, the other one is treatment of paved surfaces. They're two separate standards. So when Jack and I spoke earlier today, what I noted was they really don't have, under the standards, they don't have a groundwater recharge requirement to meet here because they're not increasing their impervious footprint. That's one standard. The other standard is water quality for trafficked areas. And because the parking lot's being reconstructed, typically under the DEP standards, treatment systems would be required for runoff generated by those surfaces. So for this project, those are not being provided, which is one of the comments we had that we didn't feel that the project met that standard. That said, the town engineer is satisfied with it. The board has the discretion to waive that standard through this process. It's our responsibility to point out that, in our opinion, it wasn't being met by the project. So that's, I don't think that hopefully clarifies a little bit instead of confuses the issue, but we're throwing around a bunch of terms that are not necessarily, shouldn't be intermingled. They're two different standards that we're referring to. In terms of the 1 foot groundwater separation from the infiltration field, because they don't really need to provide that to meet the groundwater recharge standard, as we discussed this afternoon, it is really kind of irrelevant whether or not that 2 foot separation is met. Because it's not being presented as a BMP to satisfy that particular DEP standard. So it's another discretionary item. I don't really have an objection to that. But I would suggest that the board consider whether or not, you know, it's the town's policy and thinking to require or not require treatment of paved surfaces prior to discharge to the municipal drainage system. Again, there's no, the board can waive that, and there's no overarching requirement for provision of that, but it doesn't meet the standard. So that's kind of, when Jack was saying we're a little bit in disagreement, I think that was the area that we were kind of off base on. So that said, we did issue a series of initial comments in our initial review letter. I think most of those were addressed by the revised plans. I think Green and we possibly had a couple of overlapping comments that were addressed. Other than that, the only other stuff that we had in here was that we felt that because this is a plan that the board's approving, that's going to be considered a construction document, that there should be some erosion control shown. We're not tributary to a wetland system, but this site is tributary to the municipal drainage system. So we feel it's appropriate that the plan should have that information on there. We had some comments about the grading that was shown on the drawing, and I don't think they were really addressed on this plan, and Jack can respond to those. Based on the limited number of proposed grades that were shown in the parking lot, it's fairly flat, very flat in some areas. Some of the pavement seemed as though it was being graded above the adjacent threshold openings to the buildings. We just highlighted that. Again, those aren't really related to any of the zoning bylaw or site plan review requirements. It just related to constructability. And I think that was really about it. I mean, the main question that we had was whether or not the board would ask the applicant to, you know, provide water quality treatment for the pavement. And if any of that was unclear, which I'm sure a bunch of it was, a lot of mumbo jumbo associated with that, just, you know, feel free to ask me to clarify if you have to.
I guess my question, thoughts, or request is, so the net result of what you just said regarding the treatment, of the paved surfaces is, it's your opinion, we don't know if that's supported by the town engineer. I think they said it might, the town engineer may be okay without it, but we'll maybe have that discussion.
I guess that's what I'm trying to get across is, we're not really presenting that as an opinion. We're
right.
Presenting it as a statement that standard is not being met.
Okay.
Under our interpretation of the DEP standard associated with that. And it's, you know, doing it for a long time. So that's what the standard is.
Right. So you're dotting your I's and crossing your T's in your advice to the town.
It's not an opinion whether or not they should provide it or not. It's right. Just a statement that in terms of compliance with that standard, we don't believe it's being met.
What type of treatment normally flows from this type of requirement?
There's a number of different methods, and I really wouldn't want to get into suggesting any one over another.
Right.
I mean, there are a number of ways to do it, but
okay.
It's going to be up to the applicant.
All right. Do any of the other board members have any questions for the peer review consultant? Chime in. We don't have to go in order. No? None? Chris, any comments?
I lost track for a second. Matt, in your opinion, this is a redevelopment project or is not?
It is, but that doesn't mean that you don't need to meet those standards.
Okay.
It means that there's some leeway and you need to meet them to the greatest practical extent under the state standards.
Got it.
And because the paved surfaces may be considered new construction, it doesn't meet the standard.
Because it's being reconstructed. If they were resurfacing the existing parking lot and they weren't doing, and this is a typical DEP interpretation. I have no idea what the Redding Conservation Commission may or may not, you know, approve in that circumstance, but the typical DEP interpretation of that aspect of the redevelopment section of the standards is that if it's being reconstructed, it's a new item for example, if they were rebuilding the building and weren't touching the parking lot, they wouldn't need to provide treatment for the existing parking lot, even though it's part of that redevelopment project. Okay, but because it's being rebuilt, it's considered new construction under the state standards.
Do we know whether or not during DRT review that any CONCOM input was obtained? If they, do we know that? No? I mean, it may not be required, but...
It's not tributary to a wetland area, so...
Right, right. And so we normally wouldn't, but I imagine somebody on the DRT...
I'd have to go back and check.
No, I'm not suggesting that you have it committed to memory, Chris. I'm just, it's kind of a what-if question. You know, was there any input? And I guess even further, should we double-check to see what input from the town engineer we had, if any, in response to that specific area? That would help inform the board's decision in one way or the other. You know, we've heard the applicant's position on it. I think I heard you say to the greatest extent practicable, which kind of echoes what the applicant's position was, and then where does the town kind of come down on it?
And I can share that I had a phone conversation with the town engineer a day ago, I believe, to get ready for tonight's hearing, just to run this by him. And in the comments that he shared with me, we spoke about the 2-foot versus 1-foot separation to the bottom of the cul-de-sac. We did not discuss the treatment of the runoff of the pavement. And he was okay with the 1-foot separation. I think he was impressed by what would have been involved with raising the site to achieve the 2-foot as being perhaps not something that could be done here. So that he was reasonably okay with the treatment of the runoff. We did not discuss.
And could I just add one thing?
Sure, Jerry.
We're talking about trying to get maximum feasible compliance. Typically, if this was like a brand new site, and I was coming in and doing drainage, I'd have deep sump catch basins with gas hoods, storm scepter units, all that. Okay, so you get into a full-blown drainage conventional design, something like that. In this case, right now, the parking lot just sheet flows to the catch basins. So what I tried to do is I did put in a riprap channel, so water coming down will hit the riprap, so you'll have some removal of sediment. You do have a rain garden, so there's another area that you could have... You know, that's just basically a small depression with landscape. So, that'll provide some treatment as well. The total treatment, typically when you look at total suspended solid removal, you look for 80% on new construction. To achieve that, you need a storm scepter. Storm scepter is about $10,000 just for the unit. In this case, I looked at this site as there's no pretreatment now. I'm adding some. It may not be at 80%, but... I'm improving the situation, so that's what I'm basing my case on. And without the addition of a storm scepter unit, I'll never get the 80% removal. You can try to put things in series to try to achieve the 80%, but it's very difficult.
Gotcha.
Jack, you said you did talk to the town engineer. He called you.
We did. Not to interrupt you, John, but we really only did talk about the 1-foot separation. We didn't get into treatment.
Okay. My question is, there's been discussion back and forth, but nothing in writing. Is there a possibility to get something in writing from the town engineer relative to on the separation as proposed by the applicant and Jack? As the engineer on the team, so that what has been presented tonight by I think both parties, our peer review specialist and the engineer seems to be, at least in my mind, very appropriate and reasonable that which is being proposed. I mean, The only other option is you don't touch the parking lot at all because it's redevelopment, and then if you do have problems down the road, somebody's gonna come back and say, well, why didn't you do something about it? So, but to do it correctly, if we were gonna go by code now, which is upgraded all the time, we'd have to pick up the building, do something with the substrate of where the building is sitting, and raise the parking lot, which is not realistic. I mean, it's tearing the whole thing down and rebuilding it, which is not what we wanna do. So my question is, can we get something from a town engineer addressing this so that we, the board, would have something in writing from the town where it's looking at both sides of the equation and give us their best guesstimate?
And to what Matt stated, he has a point. Even if the town engineer said, I'm okay with it, it still might require a waiver from this board.
And I think that's the good point, is that you are able to waive the DEP regulation because it's you're working with it here because it's in your site plan review, part of your zoning bylaw. In order to grant that waiver, however, you probably ought to be satisfied that the applicant's done all that it can, you know, the most that it can do to achieve the standards. So, you know, the applicant has made that representation to you already. And Matt has reviewed it and pointed out that it doesn't get all the way to achieving the actual standard itself. If you want the town engineer to weigh in and say that they may be a little bit short, but I'm nonetheless satisfied, we can reach out to the town engineer and ask that he do that. He, I think, may, to his mind, already have said that in the memo that he did back in January, but given the additional information that's come in from Matt and from the applicant, maybe it makes sense to take one more pass at it and ask him to commit, look at it one more time and see if he can commit that to you in writing.
Yeah, I think it would be helpful to have it as part of the record. You know, if it's not already, and I haven't seen anything, but that doesn't mean it's not there.
You have in the file.
In the DRT.
There's also a memo from the engineer back in January.
It's probably in the book that we got originally.
Probably, but the plans have changed since then, and you know.
To the extent that can be updated.
And we've had another round of engineering performed on your behalf from Nitch. So I think taking a look at it.
Probably a simple ask. All right, any other questions as it relates to, I guess, engineering? None?
Chair, if I could make a quick comment, just with regards to the point of a waiver, I don't think there's a specific waiver regarding DEP standards that's required here. We have requested a site plan approval waiver, and I think it really would fall within that. I guess the best way I can characterize this, I don't think we have to do this, but we chose to do this, and that's what's triggering this additional review part of it. And so to the extent that we need a waiver, I think we are looking for that through the site plan review waiver that we're seeking, but I don't know if there's necessarily another waiver that we do need here. We do have the memo from the engineering back in January, where they were pretty detailed with their comments, and they did approve the drainage plan, et cetera, as well. Just to point that out.
All right, thanks. And we'll just get maybe a quick update. Or is his opinion today still consistent with what it is back then, given the new information? Simple, easy.
That's what you're looking for?
Should be.
Yeah.
Yeah, should be simple, easy.
I expect that that's what he would say, yeah. But yeah. It makes sense to.
Let's just have it as part of the record.
Just another piece of paper.
Just, yeah, have it as part of the record. A couple of, anybody from Green here? No.
We got the letter back in from Green. I looked it over, and it looked to me, to my eyes, pretty clean. There are a couple comments, outstanding comments, but they were very minor. I think that the complete list of outstanding comments from the Green letter were there may still not be shown bike storage on the plans. Right. He was hoping that would be shown. And also the angle of the no parking and standing signs as depicted on the plans needs to be, I think, rotated ever so slightly. And I think that was it.
Okay. And so while you're on the subject of signage, that typically would be something that is in the purview of, I think, the selectmen, to, as road commissioners, don't they have jurisdiction over signs as well?
That's a good question. The selectmen certainly have jurisdiction over whether or not you can or cannot park within the right-of-way.
Right.
So the actual ability to park a car on the street, I think, is certainly within the selectmen. And they probably have jurisdiction over the signs as well.
All right. And so as part of our discussion, I think we want to take into consideration whether or not we want a condition for that as part of our decision, or whether or not we think that the selectmen will want to hear about that prior to. And again, this board has the jurisdiction to grant everything related to this 40B, but as we dealt with before, when the selectmen have jurisdiction over certain parking-related areas, they may, it may be something that they want to pay attention to before our decision or even know about. So we'll figure that out as the process goes on, and whether we condition for it or, I mean, we're making good progress. Go ahead.
Can I add one thing on the signage? I would think the Board of Selectmen would only deal with signage that's within the right-of-way of Woburn Street. The signage that we are showing is on private property. I'm not sure they get involved in that, but that's a point of discussion only.
Well, yeah, we could I guess try to figure that out, but I guess it's the no parking is along the right of way, is it not?
It is along Woburn.
It's a good point. There are going to be two signs within the right of way, so you're correct.
So again, something to think about as to whether or not that merits.
No, you're right.
Something that the selectmen want to be
involved with.
I mean, they'll be involved with it one way or another, I would imagine, and whether we condition for it as part of a decision or prior to, again, like I said, we're making good time, so in terms of the conduct of the hearing.
I think that, Chairman, if I could, I think that might be something we'd also request a waiver on, so we don't have to go to an additional board for an additional permit, so we can do this as a comprehensive permit. And I know that the Park and Traffic Transportation Task Force did weigh in on this and submitted a memo as well supporting the signage. So it might be a waiver that we would actually move to add to the applications.
All right. Can you submit a full list of waivers?
I will do
next
so.
Next time, mm-hmm. So we have, because we're getting close.
Oh,
so,
sure. In fact, I think
one of the things
is,
that we're going to want to do before too long is go through your list of waivers, and you know, give you some feedback on those.
And on that point, we sort of wrestled with this question a little bit. Doesn't concern you guys, but we wrestled with this in the last 40B hearing before this board, about whether this board has the legal authority to affect the rights to use the public right-of-way. Because that really goes not to so much the town's permitting authority, but the town's authority as owner of the right-of-way. And the last time around, there was a request to stake off public right-of-way as loading zone. This strikes me as completely dissimilar to that request, but that did go to the selectmen rather than to this board. So I think ultimately, if we're going to designate a space within the right-of-way as no parking, which I think everybody agrees is a good idea and ought to be done, I'm not convinced that that's something that this board can give you. I think that would probably have to be given by the board. And if you disagree, which you're entitled to do, we should probably talk about that.
So let's wrestle with it a little bit and see if between now and next time we're back here, we have a better handle on that. I think that's unreasonable. In terms of, I mean, what other outstanding items? I think you did yeoman's work with the loading zone. That was a concern. Still looking for I&I relief?
We are.
Okay. You know, that's something that I think you'll get feedback from various members of the board about. We all live in this town, and we know how precious town dollars are these days, so we want to keep that in mind as representatives of the town while we consider any and all parts of this application. Were there any other outstanding items for discussion? Go ahead, John.
In looking through the Green Report, it came up a couple of places. One was entering and exiting the project. And we have, this reverts again to signage too. At key times of the day, high peak traffic areas, or times, I should say, I know how busy that area can be, especially from about 7-ish in the morning until about 9-ish, and then in the afternoon somewhere between 4:30, 5 o'clock, and 6:30, 7 o'clock. If you're going out of the project early in the morning, your tendency is that you may want to come out of the project and make a left. To do that, you're tying up traffic. Going into the project, you may be coming in the opposite direction and want to make a left into the project, coming down off of Mover Street across the tracks. We have in certain areas of the town a no turn at peak hours of the either morning or the evening. Would that be a consideration to alleviate traffic at the lights at the train? I get very nervous with traffic in that crossing, especially having been on site when the individual with the truck went over the one in Wakefield and just ignored what, medically or whatever, and was taken down the track about 400 feet. I happened to be there and tracked the train down, but I mean, there were gates there. But this one I see with backup people trying to get in and get out of the development. Would it be worthwhile to consider? I just throw that out there. I'm not asking to do that. I'm just a consideration. Green did not mention that, but it's been a thought in my mind because we do that right now on Salem Street, keeping people off the back to try to skirt the normal traffic lights. Because it's the same time that the junior high school is coming, people dropping off, that crosswalk becomes an issue at the same time too. So I'm trying to...
Food for thought. There are members of the public here, so I'll turn the meeting over to any public comment. The folks have any comments to make to the board as part of the hearing?
No.
All right. Hearing none, I'll close the public comment portion of the hearing. So let's think about scheduling, timing, progress. I think we're making good progress. I think there are only a few items left. I think, Chris, you let me know, and everybody let me know. I think probably the next time we meet, we ought to see that updated list of waivers. Perhaps we'll have those issues that we discussed tonight, engineering-wise, perhaps Board of Selectmen-wise, with the signage perhaps nailed down, at least for discussion points. And I would imagine, we could be getting ready to draft a decision. Probably perhaps either at the next, the next hearing, following the next hearing, we'll be ready to start drafting a decision.
I would imagine by then.
Yeah, we don't need to drag this out unnecessarily. It's a fairly straightforward project with a couple of, significant but remedy, issues that can be remedied one way or the other, whether the board conditions for them or waives them, that we ought to be able to. I don't think we need any more peer review. Let's go down the list. I think we've peer reviewed this to the point that's done. Some internal town feedback, board comments. Once we get the request for waivers in, we can bat those around perhaps at the next hearing, maybe even a short one, and then decide whether or not we want to close the hearing, I think.
How are we doing on the
time? You want want to have in hand as relatively agreeable as this applicant has been, you do want to have a reasonably full draft decision in front of you after having discussed the waivers before you close the public hearing. Because you want to give the applicant an opportunity to say,
these waivers are going to make it economically unfeasible. Okay, all right, so then it makes sense for following the next hearing, we maybe even schedule a more expedited hearing. Maybe we don't have to wait 30 days, although we want to give you as much of a comfort zone as you can and give you enough time to do what you have to do.
I can start sketching out now the sort of
framework.
Objective parts of the decision. There's going to be some findings of fact that are going to be just describing the project, and before you start getting into conditions, there's going to be some standard conditions that you probably have put in every comprehensive permit you've ever issued. So I can start already sketching out the sort of skeleton of the of what the decision would look like, assuming it's an approval, which we haven't actually discussed yet. But you know, given the way that the hearing has gone thus far, I can take a stab trying to put together a very preliminary draft, leaving holes where there are outstanding open issues.
All right, I guess draft and then to be published following, filling in the blanks regarding the waivers made public, perhaps following discussions and a hearing on the waivers list and any other outstanding items. And then we can have a conversation about closing the hearing. Whether or not we're ready, whether the applicant wants to provide any other feedback based upon that, how much time you need to do that, if any, then we can discuss possibly closing the hearing.
Yes.
After we've given the applicant an opportunity to provide feedback on the waivers.
I think the waivers.
And
the,
any conditions.
I see the next, so that's, I think, the one step out. The next step between now and then is dealing with the open issues we've identified, which are, you know, securing the no parking along between the two access drives, determining whether there will be, whether the drainage as shown is satisfactory to the town engineer, notwithstanding the non-compliance with the DEP standard. And I think the corollary there is whether there's any additional, if the DEP standard is not achievable, is there any additional measures the applicant can provide to get closer to achieving the standard? So that's the conversation with the town engineer. Need to hear reporting back on that. Put together a draft decision. Talk about the waivers. Talk about the conditions. Then we're somewhere.
Okay.
But I know I just didn't want to diminish the importance of the open issues.
Right. No, and I don't diminish them either. And so in terms of the applicant's close, but they haven't achieved it. Who's gonna opine as to whether or not there are steps to be taken to come closer?
I think the answer there is that we tasked Matt and Nitch with looking at whether or not they were satisfying not just DEP standards,
but every
standard that you guys are wrestling with. Matt has provided the opinion that they don't satisfy that one, but the peer reviewer's job is not to re-engineer a project or to improve a project.
No.
So that, I think, is a discussion that we can now sort of switch over to the applicant and the town engineer.
All right. That's what I thought. I wanted to be clear about it, because I certainly didn't expect the peer reviewer to do it. All right. Any other comments by the board? Go ahead, John.
What's our calendar look like? Where are we on the 180 days?
I checked it this morning, and I believe our 180-day hearing window extends through mid-August. That was based on my checking my calendar and thinking that we had opened this hearing in February. That sounds
about
right.
We're in
quite good shape.
Yeah.
Better than other 40B hearings I've ever been involved with. So we have until August to just close the hearing. which you're working backward from there, if we've got a working draft, and are talking about all these other issues a month from now, then I think we're in pretty great shape.
All right, so next hearing, if we're pushing us out a month, is June 15th. It's the next open night where we have, at least as we sit here now, nothing on, and we prefer to keep it with a night we have nothing on, if at all possible, so that we can address you guys and not make you wait.
If there's any possible earlier date, we're simply facing a financing urgency with regards to how many financing applications under this program can be applied for within a certain period of time. We're actually coming up on that. I know it's not the board's concern, but from our perspective, we're hoping to try to move things. And I do think we can probably get the engineer's memo within the next week. And I have a list of waivers. I actually wrote it today. There's only one additional, and that's it. So I can submit that very easily tomorrow or Monday. Other than that, I believe it's just updating our plan. And I'll deal with Chris about the question on the Board of Selectmen approval for signage in the way. So I don't think we have a lot more to provide.
All right, let's see. So we've got now perhaps two hearings next week, one on for June 1st. You know, Chris, I want to give you a little bit of leeway as well. I mean, I understand, you know, I'm not putting this on you. I'm not putting you under the gun. You know, typically we would normally extend for 30 days to allow for getting done what needs to be done in between. We've heard the applicant's request to shorten it. Again, we like to have these hearings on nights when there's nothing else scheduled so that we can devote all our attention to you. The next night that's open for that is June 15th. Perhaps that gives us all enough time, everybody enough time to get, for you to get your hands around things that you need to get your hands around, and you know, perhaps you'll have, you know, more luck in getting that done quicker, but I don't want to put any pressure on that, undue pressure on that.
I think I would have a hard time getting a usable draft to you guys by the 1st. I can promise to have one reporting by the 15th. So the question is whether you...
Well, I don't think we need a draft by the next time we get together, because we're still going to hammer out a couple of issues. I mean, you know, certainly in your own schedule and mind, you know, put a framework together and, you know, and start putting your work product together. And then once we iron out the remaining issues that you've outlined and come back, I mean, the next hearing will probably be shouldn't be very long, unless we have protracted discussion regarding the waivers, which I see as, you know, or the other major issues that you've discussed. I'm inclined to just keep it on the 15th because it's an open night that has nothing on it. Does anybody have any
draft conditions that
any issues with that?
Well, because we could address more if we had on the 1st, we'd still have to wait potentially another 2, 3, 4 weeks before we could have the final in maybe some of the draft decision items. So putting the two together, we'd be better off putting it the 15th and try to get a lot of it done.
Yeah, I mean, maybe that does give you enough time to publish the draft. I mean, I'll leave that completely
anyway
up to you.
Yeah.
Maybe by the 15th, it maybe won't be the final draft, but
I can assure you it won't be the final draft. But you know, once we hammer out the waivers and conditions, then we won't be too far away, I don't think.
Would Chris have draft conditions on the 15th?
I would have by the 15th a list of what I would take to be standard Reading comprehensive permit conditions that they haven't talked about, and ones, any that I can extract from the peer review, as you know, things that they're suggesting that you guys do going forward that haven't been shown in the current plans. So I think yes, I could have this. I could have a non-comprehensive list of draft conditions by the 15th.
All right, so that'll give us some more things to talk about, perhaps, and accomplish. Give him enough time to put that together. So
it would help if we have the to start going over conditions in addition to the waivers would help us a lot.
Sure, and we're cognizant of the timeline, and and we appreciate and are sensitive to your business concern, business financial concerns, and, you know, we want to get it right. So we'll try to move it along pretty quickly once we get back on the 15th. So let's keep it on the 15th, and hopefully we'll have a little bit more to talk about than
we
originally imagined.
Thank
right?
you.
I'll take a motion to continue. Please entertain a motion to continue to June 15th. Second?
Second.
Robert, any discussion on the continuation to the 15th? Hearing none, all those in favor? Okay, we'll continue to the 15th. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
Do we
you
have
guys
any,
all signed in.
Do we have any other business? No. You want to talk about anything, Kathy?
No.
Okay, good.
I had a question.
I'm good.
All right.
Kim?
Yes.
We originally had this hearing set up for this hearing tonight in 40B. But all of a sudden we got this
Belmont Street?
How did that get in there?
Somebody promised them a date?
Yes. Glenn put it on there before this was updated. Glenn looks at it, says, oh, the next one's this. Maureen comes out and says, oh, I said, oh, Glenn, there's a 40B now that he promised her. And then, so then. So
he promised her, and then we continued it.
And then we continued
it. Yeah. So he tried to push her through, and then it.
Yeah, that was
that's
just
why, and I told him, but it came out afterwards, even though I told him that, but his piece of paper did not say it. So.
Anything else we need to talk about? Motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second? All those in favor? All right, we're adjourned. Thanks, Kim.